problem between the natives that now has, you know, the knowledge of other things that are the traditional national generation in the same time with the generation. The answer was basically has to do with they should be happy that navigators are still alive and continuously because of the fact that he is teaching other people, and it means that the spirit and the life navigation is going to leave instead of dying. So, I mean, they can't find anybody to continue the tradition, so that means they can kill them off, basically. So, the fact that he's teaching somebody else allows the tradition and education to live forever. Does that make sense? Yeah, so, so, what I'll say is what? Oh, that's a bomb. If you get it, that was up to here. What's that? It's a good habit.
While you were like selling, I was just wondering of what kind of things you're like using as a net. Is it possible to like share?
Well, by doing the navigational skills, you see now that this is traditional. I don't think that we used map before. By guiding the canoe, if you want to learn navigation and when you know the stars, then you're guiding your canoe by the stars, by the ocean swells, and the sun. And I don't think that we use map on the canoe. Thank you.
Solo, y te di tiro una porra o se fare de pique. Me iba a hacer rap saco, fare de nada. Me iba a hacer rap saco, huidro. Pues ahí, guiri a un rap tobri. Y era la cosa se torre en defender de saco, saco. Y un carro de cote se hubo. Saco, a carro de cote se hubo. Ir itu cara kuliah kita fluid, cara kuliah kita yang wah, lebih terkali rasa tu. Ia silikon nak pasai skrin. Si boleh ada cara kuli kuli itu never ada tadi, sah. Rubi sih.
Rena pun ia awas apa siapa siapa dari kaya jika saya awas mereka orang orang deh dia kita setorong saya pun siwas setorong setorong. Kalau dari fasa orang ini apa kita sepuh tak wajarlah mereka kasi kaya ngadi siapa orang sepuh. Rena pun perkara serangan antar. Jepar secara umum, secara kerjaan, saya tahu tamu dari, yang mungkin di rapat, metai, ciri orang-orang di daru, suri dah, awas juga serus, ye, ya apa-apa punya, kita terawang ya,
That depends on the number of people on the boat, and we have on the canoe, we have the people making decisions on that. So I cannot give you the answer. They have to think about it. Because we have only so many people to put on the canoe at one time. Yeah, we have already gotten, just so that you know, we have a city view on the Bratin Kusai, the Dabi Kusai, the city Kusai, and the port. Γιατί ότι η ώρα τι πόρα πέρα αυτή τη σειρή και μου σε ρη πόρα πέρα δεν πούνε. Αθέν, αφήτε αυτή και η ώρα τι βήκε. Γιατί ότι είναι σήτη αυτή απόρτσο αυτή δεν βήκε. Εγώ τη δύο ρίτσο τσου, πότα και άω και πιστε τσο τσου γίνει να μόνο. Γίνεται ρόπ καπασίσι και απόρο καπατσέρο βήκε. Ελά, άγωρο νόμ, το βή με άγρα που σύνει, γιατί θα βάζει το πόρο εγώ. Το ρίβα. If I were to, also, I'm sorry, the answer is it's kind of difficult because we have enough people. Yeah, you can't worry about somebody trying to represent Chuuk. We have people representing Chuuk on this trip all the way down. I say so, sorry. The question has to do with, for us, for the culture here, learning the traditional navigation, we have our lava lava. And is there any symbol of what is basically with the attire, I guess that's what he's basically referring to.
I was expecting that the crews will be coming with a custom, the traditional custom, Hawaiian custom. In exchanging of what we are doing here, and in the best interest of our students to see how the Hawaiians are dressed, so we can know, we can identify that these are the people that came from Hawaii. Not by introducing you. Even when you came in without introducing you, we know where you're from. By the identity that you brought. That's the concern I have. Why aren't you wearing those valuable identities that you brought from Hawaii? If you want us to maintain this culture and tradition, way of living, and dress, talk, or whatever.
Okay, let me answer part of that question.
In 1995, when Hopefully I sailed, one of the attires, if I'm not mistaken, for the crew members was to dress traditionally, and some of them did. Our focus on this particular journey is not so much on tradition as much as it is on honor Mao. And I think we need to understand here that in Hawaii, our traditions are not as strong in some respect as they used to, as we learn from our kupuna, from our elders, and from the books that we read, that we were no different from what you folks, how you dress today, your elders. We wear the malu, we wear the wrap, the women were topless, and that was what it was. But because our focus is mainly to bring Mao home, to honor him and to show him the respect that is so long overdue to him, that the tradition of our the attires that we would have worn traditionally was not the big focus point.
That was just a clarification of who actually taught him, whether it was his brothers, or his father, or his father, and he clarified that it was his grandfather. And he got inducted into the navigation through some from Polomar. That is his brother, so here's a clarification.
Can I ask you a technical question?
I think all of you are pretty happy to share with our navigator, right? And if you have a chance to go with the famous Christmas man in the world, you be more happier than sharing with this.
We have to choose between sailing with, now that we sailed with Grandmaster Navigator Piailug, man, versus if you were to be offered by a rich multi-million guy to sail with him on his yacht. Would you prefer to go sail on that or sail with him? Of course, may
Sorry, there was a question about some visitation to some of these sacred places and whether it was known to us in Hawaii, and we planned all this before we came. And I just clarified doing that. No, it was all planned through here in Chuuk. And we thought it was a really good idea that we get to visit it. But because of all the scheduling and everything, we will have to divide our time in Italy through some of the other things. So
the Hokule experience, I'm sure, has left or has created that passion of revivalism, of culture, or everything else. And now we have this trip down here, and I'm sure it's going to live also within us, or remain an indelible passion of maybe cultural revivalism to a certain extent. But what else has this experience, or has this trip going to cause on the other end of the journey back home? What else, what other benefits maybe, or other effects that this one is going to create? Is it going to also help, like, let's say, the Hawaiian movement itself that has been going on? Pardon me if my question is out of range here.
No, it's not out of range.
You don't know it.
I think from the whole Makali'i experience, besides what Hule'a and Hawaii Loa is doing, this will help young people to continue to write songs. It will help them to continue to write chants. It will help them, the chants, which are the most important part in our culture, because that's where we were able to tell a lot of what our ancestors did, because we were an oral people and not a written language people. So this will help our young people and many of our students that you see here who attend the university. This will help them in that respect too. And because Hawaii, and you know a lot of the things that Hawaii is going through, the sailing portion is just a very minute portion of how we are trying to help Hawaii to regain back a lot of her traditional things. It'll help us as the teachers go back into the classroom and generate the interest of our students to want to come to the canoe, to want to get out into the wild, the ocean, shina, to sail.
From a point of view, from a Hawaiian Chuukis, some of you probably know me. I come down here and most of it are about business, most of it are about family, and most of it are about us. And so one of the very common problem I have in the United States or in Hawaii is when I said I'm from Chuuk, and everybody starts running their eyes rolling around, okay? And that will be the same experience you have when you come to Hawaii. Now, it's really hard to tie us with political problems or any political credits, because people don't often see, because we're so little in the Pacific. So the best way we can tell the world that we are exist, especially for your students, is that this is it. This is our family from Hawaii. They're coming to tell us that it's time for us to keep our culture. And not only that, but it's time for other people to respect us. And for us to follow through the step they're going through, it's gonna be a very well recognized, we're gonna be a very well recognized nation as well as state.
Feel it now, and I give you more credit in my course now than I ever had in the last 5 years. And I thank you for that.
Thank you.
ritual ceremonies done before this voyage started out from Hawaii? Or where are there any such thing like that to be done before any of this kind of practice taking place? And the second question, maybe I have to ask right now, were there any or are there any significant differences between the oceans of sailing to Tahiti and sailing to the Micronesian oceans, to the Micronesian oceans? Or are there any specific oceans, regions to look at it or to consider as in danger or safe or whatever that the navigators known about?
Let me go ahead and answer the first question, and okay, then, because I was on the that little ceremony. Any other ceremony that was taking place on a personal basis, I'm sure there is. But as the group, yes, there was a ceremony. I have it on video, so if you're interested, I have it.
What were the significance of the ceremonies? What are the importance of
them? In fact, prior to our journey to Tahiti, Makali is the name of our organization. And we are the caretakers of Makali. This organization was formed in 1991, and we had an opportunity to build a traditional canoe. There was a coarse search or log search on our island to find our native tree to build the canoe Hawaii Loa. And in the process of trying to locate these logs, we were not able to take it from our island because the logs that would have been used to build it were in the center of our forest. And a lot of our native trees are, we don't have a lot of them left. So we got logs from another, from the Alaska Tlingit Indians. But we were asked, the Kalaiba organization were asked to still create another fishing canoe. We brought Mao over, and he helped us by using traditional tools. And what the men of the organization did was they went up to one of our mountains, to our quarries, and brought down the stones, fashioned the ads by going to the Bishop Museum and talking to one of the archaeologists there, and he worked with the men. We went to the forest, gathered the trees to branches to make the handles, used the sennet, the coconut fibers to lash these tools. The men actually cut down the tree using these traditional tools. They fashioned the canoe using the traditional tools. Their attire was using the traditional clothing. But in the at the time before the whole project started, there was traditional ceremonies where we had to eat the certain foods. The kahuna or the priest had to come and did all of the blessings. So there are many times when we do use traditional ways. And it is still alive in Hawaii for different projects. It just depends what kind of project we are embarking on. So a lot of that is still.
The oceans and weather in Hawaii as compared to here in Micronesia. In Hawaii, the water is colder, cold water. We have our normal winds are stronger. We have trade winds that blow on average from stronger than this was blowing today. And so the water is colder. Because we're higher away from the equator, we're 20 degrees north, right? So our weather is very different from Micronesia. When we sail down to, before we got to the Marshall Islands, before Majuro, there's a definite difference. The water got warmer. The rain was warm. At home, when it rains, everybody runs underneath the shade and we all cover the raincoats. In Micronesia, when it rains, we just keep on walking. And that's a big difference. But also, what is very important here in Micronesia is the most active area of cyclonic activity. considering tropical storms and typhoons more here than anywhere else on the planet. So although your weather is nice and comfortable, you are located in a very active, very violent, dangerous area. So we planned our trip from Hawaii 2 years ago, but we didn't come here because of the bad weather. Remember the bad weather you had in the last couple of years where there were a lot of typhoons. And so that's why our trip is postponed 2 years. So yes, weather is much more pleasant here, but you're situated in a more dangerous location. In Hawaii, the weather is a little bit more harsh, but we're more safe during the typhoon season. During our winter months, around January, February, March, mostly around February, we have big waves that come from the north Gulf Coast of Alaska. And that's why surfing, riding the waves on the ocean is a very popular sport in Hawaii, one of the biggest waves usually ridden in Hawaii around that time. So we welcome your weather. It's very pleasant. We enjoy it very much over here. But we're on our way. We're trying to get to Saipan within a certain time because we know that your typhoon season will start pretty soon. So we take the good with the bad.
Sorry to all the group. My question is, I'm not speaking this to this according to our distributors. As Micronesia, should be tortured to get down. Let's talk to that early, and then put money to put away. See you again.
Bipur, okay, the question is, what does it take to become a part of this crew or become a navigator? I'm sure it's coming along. That's all I translated on the
I have two questions. My first question is, now with the stars comes out at night, so how do you find going in the stars and stand another way?
Did you see the first two?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. My second question is, what has
this
part
English?
The most communicating to our island? What do you like about our island? Is that the question in the crew?
Yeah,
the crew. I know it's party. I'll let him answer that.
The best part of being in Micronesia is just having a different experience. The food here is plentiful for the group, and it tastes good. The people, y'all have been very generous and loving and all kind of stuff. The only thing is just a little warmer down here than it is in Hawaii, but other than that, everything is great. It's a different. it's different up where we live than down here. So we have a, you, it's like in Hawaii we have that big Western influence, so everything is, I guess, modernized where we live. And to come back down here to see you, how you guys live, is just an experience in itself.
The people here has shown so much kindness, and their music, your music has been really wonderful. We went to the high school in Zaire, and Xavier, and the songs that they sang there were so beautiful. And then they would say that, you know, they were sad because they had little to give, and yet the people just kept giving and giving, and you've given so much with all of your hearts. And it makes me realize that at home, we do have people that give, but it's not the same anymore as it used to be. In our past generations, our kupunas or our families back then used to give a lot. Even with what little they had, they used to give a lot. And today with our economic the way it is, sometimes it's even hard to just give a lot. And watching all of you coming out and sharing all of your food with us, which has been really, really plentiful for us. And it's so wonderful. And this is something that we will go home and share with our families at home, even within our communities, that we really live a good life in Hawaii. And seeing the families here, some of the people, the way your living is, and your struggles is, it's really unreal in Hawaii. And we've taken things for granted. A lot of things we have taken for granted in Hawaii. And to see the way you people live has really made me appreciate life more. And I just want to go home and share this with the rest of our people at home, that they're so lucky. But thank you so much for all of your generosity.
Well, everyone is still talking, so we decided to apologize first before we crawl out. And I'm very thankful that we were able to be here. And one last thing, we're really sad because we thought that we're gonna take pictures with you guys. Thank you.
I mean, how are you guys gonna leave the canoe here, or how are you guys gonna get the... I mean, what's the plan?
Yeah, we're going to put the canoe up at the resort.
Resort? That's not actually you want to put
it. No, that's not the resort. We're going down to the Ocean Islands, and then all the way to Sarawak, and then we're going to Guam, Saipan.
And then
from Saipan, I believe we're going to put it on a ship, both the canoe and the escort boat. And the rest of them are going to swim back to Hawaii, and the canoe is a ship.
More better.
So there is a strong movement among the Pacific Islanders to fight for cultures that were lost. The question, how did we lose part of our culture? Some people said the missionaries, when they came, they forbid some of our cultures from us to practice. Now the question is very sensitive. Since Christianity has been here for a long time, how do we address that? I know it's very important to revive part of our lost cultures that are very precious to us. And how could we revive such without entering our faith in the Lord? If you have words to give us to establish local groups to revive our culture, what kind of advice you're going to give to us? We are very excited, encouraged to see you people coming out here. For your information, College of Micronesia, Embassy of Chuuk Campus. In the past year, we had courses in education. So we are very encouraged to see people really coming out. So those are some of my thoughts and my concerns, my questions. I hope you will leave us good words so we can follow your steps. Thank you.
They will, I'm sure they have answers for your questions. How do we?
To your questions, it's not an easy one. My grandfather, when Christianity came, he became a Mormon. But then one day, as he was traveling home, his lights from his car went out. So Howl came in front of him, took him home. If the Howl did not come in front of him, he would have gone over the pollen. So my grandfather said, we were Hawaiians first. Christianity came after. So he went back to his ways of the Amakua and his gods, but he still kept the ways of Christianity. When my mother was growing up, she couldn't speak Hawaiian in schools because Christianity would not allow it. And she couldn't speak Hawaiian English at home because her parents would not allow it. So, like I said, it is a touchy subject. But it's like how my Tupuna taught us, Papa Pauli Kanakamiwaoli. He's a Mormon minister, but he has passed away. So he had problems with his Mormon ministers. But as he told them, I'm Hawaiian first. When my culture needs to practice, I'll practice it. When I'm done with it, I'll go back to my Christian world.
That I do, we go into the schools and we talk about the culture of Hawaii, and many of the job that I do are basically kupuna, or elders who teach in the school. And when we turn to these elders and we ask them, what is your feelings about the Christian world and your culture? There is no separation. If we think back to our ancestors and everything that they did do, they prayed for everything. They prayed when they got up in the morning. They prayed when they went to their farms. They prayed when they went fishing. There is no separation between my culture and my Christian belief. And this is something that I share with our students throughout Hawaii, because they had a lost identity once before. And for us to have them become more confused because they live in a very modern world, we would continue to have children that are growing up with no identity. Right now, part of our program is to help these young students to identify who they are. And many of them come from Christian beliefs. So when we can introduce the culture to them and let them understand the teachings or the way Hawaii was many years ago, it is actually not very much different than having your Christian beliefs and incorporated with your cultural beliefs.
I would like to add, I personally believe we do not have all the answers, and we are trying very hard. But I would say whichever Lord, whichever God, whichever Amakua, whichever person we pray to, if there is an answer, it is truly through His power. It is truly, so I would say is to stay close to your religion, stay close to your God, stay close to who is most close to you and who helps you the most. And that as we see changes in our culture, we realize that it hasn't been changes in the way of our gods. There's been people between people the way they treat people. So we can trace that to fear, to mismanagement. We can turn it to mistrust, being unfaithful, and things like that that we possess as human beings. But my advice to you is how we feel is that stay close to your God, stay close to your religion, and that's the most important in the future.
But spirituality is that each of us has a spirit, and how we care for that spirit is very important. My grandfather was a pure Hawaiian. He practiced in the old ways. He married my grandmother, who was a pure Portuguese, who was raised in the Catholic Church and died caring for the Catholic Church. On my grandfather's deathbed, he promised her that he would be baptized a Catholic, and that he did. For my whole life being raised, my grandfather would only take us to the Catholic Church and wait in the parking lot. He would never set foot into the church. They never fought. It was a very healthy family. And this was something that was very unusual for us to observe on how a family could grow with Christianity, with my grandmother, and being very Hawaiian in the old ways with my grandfather. Now, some of these things are very difficult in how we interpret.
I'm Sonny Paulua. I'd like to add to this to the question, and I think that question is a major question. I think it's affecting not only the people in Hawaii, but it's also affecting the people in Micronesia and throughout the world. And a little bit about Hawaii. At one time we had a queen, we had a monarchy. We got a constitution and all that. And then I find, coming down here, that you still have senators, representatives, you have chiefs from a different island. And which at one time we had that. And the question is whether you enjoy that, still having a chief from a different island, which at one time we had. So the question arises in Hawaii, should we go back to those days and get back our government? Because our government, the Hawaiian government, was taken away. And this kind of put the question up that should we go back to those days? And coming back coming to Micronesia, we're looking at that we all can share. And in Hawaii, I think it's mostly a one-sided type of government that we like to get back. So Makali is playing a role that, you know, that we all can share and live together as one and know who you are and where you come from, and knowing your culture, knowing your grassroots is very important. So this is a very, very, very ticklish question that has been asked. I think there's so many answers to that question, but maybe a little, maybe not enough question, but there are a lot of answers. There's a lot of answers out there, but there are also so many questions to those answers and to that subject.
Okay, this is what they would like me to forward. They're really very thankful. They are part of this occasion. They said they started out hearing that a sailing canoe is sailing towards the north part of the Chuuk. So they heard from Mason when he announced on the radio that these people, Hawaiians, are somewhat like you are. And you know, here it's very hard to go out and experience outside. Only few people with good education like Mason and go out and see Hawaii, America, and so on and so forth. And here we are here. A lot of us we never see Polynesian people like you or OEMs. So we were looking forward to see you, really looking forward to. And we know the voyage is to honor. What was the title? What is the title? Grandmaster Piailug, to take him all the way to his smaller island. And he is there just for the honorary, but you guys are really doing the job. So we were really excited, and we are waiting for the voyage. And we know that we're going to learn from each other, not only the educational thing in which we're going to ask from you, but the physical being, just to look at you and learn the kind of person you are, you know, your color, your hair, and the way you talk, the way you eat, the way you laugh, so on and so forth. So, like somebody was mentioning, we thought that you will be getting off the boat in your custom, like the Holofa. But then we realized that we're the same, t-shirt, shorts, oh, we're about the same. And then we start to look at you and study you, and I know you're doing the same thing. And we're really thankful to the master because of his tying us together. And he's there, this voyage is existing. We had a very great opportunity to learn, not only application, as I said, but a lot of things from you. And maybe you guys learn from us. So, here they are sitting here, hearing you saying only the good things about us, like hospitality. You even said cute. Did I hear cute? They just would like to hear the bad part of us so that we can, you know, adjust and learn. Because we know they are. Don't tell me there is no bad part about you. What I mean is like you may experience seeing something that you thought it is offending. So we really want to know that too. So we can learn. Because when you come again, you will never see that again. Eh? The offending part, you may not see it again. So we would like to learn from you. So keep us our bad part, not just the good part. And before I shut my mouth, we really want to ask deeply, you know, on how navigating is operating. Like, we even want to ask how heading for Vuela, and the master said they use wave. We just really want to know how that wave, what you call that wave, what kind of wave there are, lots of wave there, and how you kite your canoe using all the waves. So we would like to really know, we hope, but we didn't want to ask, maybe it is not good in culture of application. So we just kind of lower it down. Please tell us our bad part so we will learn from it.
Anybody see anything bad about us, Chuukis? Oh, I can tell you one. There's not enough stores open late. So when we want to buy things late, we're stuck.
I respect your culture, but when I came here, the stories of what my grandparents or granduncles and aunties would tell us is what Hawaii was like many years ago in some parts. Like, for instance, we still have what we call coffee farms in Hawaii. And when you go to the coffee farms, a lot of the homes are a lot like what they are here. In our travels with the canoe, we have visited other places, and we always look for good and bad, as you will, in the different cultures that we have visited. There's a lot of questions as we're driving on our buses through town, and we see the people, and we see the police escort. And when we came, and we said, whoa, we got police escorts. What's happening here? Is it because of this big celebration? Or what was it? And we'll be very honest with you, we ask questions. and it is an education time for us. We don't know a lot about Chuuk. We don't know, we didn't know a lot about Coast Ride, as well as Makali. So for us to be here, you have to know, we ask your drivers, we ask the committee who's working with us. We're asking them all kinds of questions. Why are we having all of the police escort? And some of our people in the group are saying, I feel very spoiled now that I come here and I look at my wealth that I have at home in Hawaii. And wealth to us in Hawaii is very, very small. Many of us come from all kinds of backgrounds. When we were in Ponape, the hotel we were staying at and their cafeteria, the roof was leaking. And he apologized for it. I said, oh, we have that at home too. He turned to me and he says, I cannot believe you. And when I took it back to the rest, some of our people, and they said, oh, let him come to my house. Our houses are no different. Maybe they're built structurally different, but we have a lot of the same situations. It might look, our yards might be a little bit more manicured. We might have a lot of different things than what we see here, but a lot of our problems are a little bit no different than what you have and what you're facing today.
Ustedes no la incluyen, por Itanobo Rian, por Federur, por Farra, por Sobu, por Ayrumarfar, por Apepeo Ulfa. Quiere para ir que ya, torre, y a raro tiri. Y si le meto a ver a raro tiri, por una, para tirar caca, para dar solo a raro, y le auto de cano. Ya yo voy a decir, ay, si quiere meter, todo la para ir carne, no, reporado serán, ya puede, él es muy bien, pues. Casi le digo, me lo fai, casi le digo, no, me lo fai, fai, me lo 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 fai, me lo.
Ifan, how do you come across Makali? Can we participate in the player and then the other second one?
I was swimming in the ocean and they picked me up.
That's a question to me.
How did I come across Makali? Well, you know, I'm very strong about our culture. Even though I'm in Hawaii, it's always a struggle, so that you know. I have been very much participated in a lot of the activities in Hawaii that has to do with culture in Hawaii. And I live in a very tough city of Honolulu, so for me, every day is always a struggle. And when I found out about the canoe, Hokulea, where it was first built, it has been an interest of mine to keep my ears open and find out what's going on and can I be a part of it. I never get a chance. It was very difficult because of my schedule. Until at one point, I saw it in a little newspaper. It says, Makali's voyage to Micronesia. And there's a phone number on the very bottom of that newspaper that I mentioned. So I pick up the phone and I call a gentleman named Clay Bitterman, which is the older brother of Shorty. And that's the husband of Andy Easy right there. And from that point, I asked whether I could help because I want to find out about myself because it's been a struggle, as I've been telling you. Any folks know about me. You know, here in the islands, it's always something. When I left the area, it was very little I knew about my own. That includes my own grandfather, who was a navigator. Never learned from him because I was more educated in the ocean life. So that's how I got started. I first talked to them, and from that point on, there was the relationship, the beginning of a new relationship for me. And when I first really come to see the place where they build the canoe, and I felt just touched. If I could best describe how I felt that time, it would be best described like when I was here, I was a part of the youth program here. the Christianity program. And when I first part of that Christianity program, I was really, really touched, and I was part of the whole group that goes around all the islands and carry out the word of God. And that's exactly how I feel touched, and that's why, to this extent, all the energy and everything that I put into this, it's not because of me, but it's more because of us, all of us. So when you see me up here, when you see me doing things, don't think I'm doing for any reason or any purpose, but for all of us. And it's not just us here, but there are some of us. And that's how I got involved. And from there on, these are my family right here. There is of them. I feel like they're my brothers and sisters. And you know, when you're in Hawaii, you're very far, far from the family. So the closest I can be to you is to have them around me. And they always be very supportive and being nice to me. So that's how I pick up part of this.
Does this brings you more harmonious culturally, traditional
culturally,
experience you
experienced? Culturally? When I saw the canoe in Koh Shrai, I have tears in my eyes. When I saw in Panape, there was enough tears in my eyes. And when I came in from the passage, the northeast pass, that I saw the canoe all the way into here, it's just too much. And if the question about harmony, I think I never have my life been balanced. I hope that until now it feels really good. And this is as far as I can go back and feel what my grandfather went through, you know, just like what they're trying to discover, what their ancestry went through and their great-grandparents. It is a satisfaction, and I know I like to share with everyone, and that's why I've been trying to get on the radio to talk about that, because it's very spiritually involved, and I'm just so thankful for everyone, including also the person who literally made this trip happen. Is our Grand Master Navigator. Yes, it is very harmonious to me. Siguro ka pa si Isaiah, kung akan magat span so last question.
You decided to retire. Okay, second one is, I was watching when you came in. Okay, by that causeway, the sails were down. What is this?
Regarding a retire, I already said to our sister Sarah here. We said, we went retired in the not for that and so retired. But if you feel like a banana, you would start retired. You make a science of Sarah. She did not do it. Sarah, no matter what if I do it, as you would have. As you would have a master. Where we are retired not for it. I said, you know, I'm on the side.
The question was if there's anyone that's ready to take over the responsibility of like the speaker, if he's retired, who's going to be the next Eli? You're saying that there's some folks already there, so, you know, guys in Sarawak that has been doing this, so these are the ones who's going to step up. In our culture, there's no such thing as retired from anything. The only time you retire is when you die. That's the only time. So that's the answer. The other question was about why were we dropping sales and then raise it again? I can answer that in English, yeah. That was it's a part of a protocol to respect